This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. William I, Old Norman, Williame I, Old English, Willelm I, c. 1028. The neighboring county of Maine in the 1050s and early 1060s, William became a contender for the throne of England, then held by the childless Edward the Confessor, his first cousin once removed. There were other potential claimants, including the powerful English Earl Harold Godwinson, who was named the next king by Edward on the latter's deathbed in January 1066. William argued that Edward had previously promised the throne to him, and that Harold had sworn to support William's claim. William built a large fleet and invaded England in September 1066. Decisively defeating and killing Harold at the Battle of Hastings on 14 October 1066. After further military efforts, William was crowned king on Christmas Day 1066. In London, he made arrangements for the governance of England in early 1067 before returning to Normandy. Several unsuccessful rebellions followed, but by 1075, William's hold on England was mostly secure, allowing him to spend the majority of the rest of his reign on the continent. William's final years were marked by difficulties in his continental domains, troubles with his eldest son, and threatened invasions of England by the Danes in 1086. William ordered the compilation of the Domesday Book, a survey listing all the landholders in England along with their holdings. William died in September 1087 while leading a campaign in northern France, and was buried in Caen. His reign in England was marked by the construction of castles, the settling of a new Norman nobility on the land, and change in the composition of the English clergy. He did not try to integrate his various domains into one empire, but instead continued to administer each part separately. William's lands were divided after his death. Normandy went to his eldest son, Robert Curthose, and his second surviving son, William Rufus, received England. Contents 1. Background 2. Early life 3. Duke of Normandy 31. Challenges 32. Consolidation of power 33. Appearance and character 34. Norman administration 4. English and continental concerns 5. Invasion of England 51. Harold's preparations 52. William's preparations 53. Tostig and Hardrada's invasion 54. Battle of Hastings 55. March on London 6. Consolidation 61. First actions 62. English resistance 63. Church affairs 7. Troubles in England and the continent 71. Danish raids and rebellion in the north 72. Revolt of the Earls 73. Troubles at home and abroad 74. Last years 8. William as king 81. Changes in England, castles, forests, and nobles 82. Administration 83. Domesday Book 9. Death and aftermath 10. Legacy 11. Family and children 12. Notes 13. Citations 14. References 15. External links. Background. Norsemen first began raiding in what became Normandy in the late 8th century. Permanent Scandinavian settlement occurred before 911, when Rollo, one of the Viking leaders, and King Charles the Simple of France reached an agreement surrendering the county of Rouen to Rollo. The lands around Rouen became the core of the later Duchy of Normandy. Normandy may have been used as a base when Scandinavian attacks on England were renewed at the end of the 10th century, which would have worsened relations between England and Normandy. In an effort to improve matters, King Æthelred the Unready took Emma of Normandy, sister of Duke Richard II, as his second wife in 1002. Danish raids on England continued, and Æthelred sought help from Richard, taking refuge in Normandy in 1013 when King Swine I of Denmark drove Æthelred and his family from England. Swine's death in 1014 allowed Æthelred to return home, but Swine's son Canute contested Æthelred's return. Æthelred died unexpectedly in 1016, and Canute became King of England. Æthelred and Emma's two sons, Edward and Alfred, went into exile in Normandy while their mother, Emma, became Canute's second wife. After Canute's death in 1035, the English throne fell to Harold Harefoot, his son by his first wife, while Harthacnut, his son by Emma, became king in Denmark. England remained unstable. Alfred returned to England in 1036 to visit his mother and perhaps to challenge Harold as king. One story implicates Earl Godwin of Wessex in Alfred's subsequent death, but others blame Harold. Emma went into exile in Flanders until Harthacnut became king following Harold's death in 1040. And his half-brother Edward followed Harthacnut to England. Edward was proclaimed king after Harthacnut's death in June 1042. Early life. Chateau de Falaise in Falaise, Lower Normandy, France. William was born in an earlier building here. William was born in 1027 or 1028 at Falaise, Normandy, most likely towards the end of 1028. He was the only son of Robert I, Duke of Normandy, son of Richard II, Duke of Normandy. His mother, Herleva, was the daughter of Fulbert of Falaise. Fulbert may have been a tanner or embalmer, she was possibly a member of the ducal household, but did not marry Robert. Instead, she later married Herleva de Conqueror, with whom she had two sons. Minority Robert also had a daughter, Adelaide of Normandy. By another mistress, Robert became Duke of Normandy on 6 August 1027, succeeding his elder brother Richard III, who had only succeeded to the title the previous year. Robert and his brother had been at odds over the succession, and Richard's death was sudden. Robert was accused by some writers of killing his brother, a plausible but now unprovable charge. Conditions in Normandy were unsettled, as noble families despoiled the church and Alan III of Brittany waged war against the duchy, possibly in an attempt to take control. By 1031, Robert had gathered considerable support from noblemen, many of whom would become prominent during William's life. They included Robert's uncle, Robert the Archbishop of Rouen, who had originally opposed the Duke, Osborne, a nephew of Gunnor, the wife of Duke Richard I, and Count Gilbert of Brienne, a grandson of Richard I. After his accession, Robert continued Norman support for the English princes Edward and Alfred, who were still in exile in northern France. There are indications that Robert may have been briefly betrothed to a daughter of King Canute, but no marriage took place. It is unclear if William would have been supplanted in the ducal succession if Robert had had a legitimate son. Earlier dukes had been illegitimate, and William's association with his father on ducal charters appears to indicate that William was considered Robert's most likely heir. In 1034, Duke Robert decided to go on pilgrimage to Jerusalem, although some of his supporters tried to dissuade him from undertaking the journey. Robert convened a council in January 1035 and had the assembled Norman magnates swear fealty to William as his heir before leaving for Jerusalem. He died in early July at Nicaea. On his way back to Normandy, Duke of Normandy challenges diagram showing William's family relationships. Names with, under them, were opponents of William, and names with, were supporters of William. Some relatives switched sides over time, and are marked with both symbols. Emma on this chart as Emma of Ivry, not Emma of Normandy. Richard I on this chart as Richard I of Normandy, not Richard I of England. William faced several challenges on becoming Duke, including his illegitimate birth and his youth. The evidence indicates that he was either 7 or 8 years old at the time. He enjoyed the support of his great-uncle, Archbishop Robert, as well as the King of France, Henry I, enabling him to succeed to his father's duchy. The support given to the exiled English princes in their attempt to return to England in 1036 shows that the new Duke's guardians were attempting to continue his father's policies, but Archbishop Robert's death in March 1037 removed one of William's main supporters, and conditions in Normandy quickly descended into chaos. The anarchy in the duchy lasted until 1047, and control of the young duke was one of the priorities of those contending for power at first. Alan of Brittany had custody of the duke, but when Alan died in either late 1039 or October 1040, Gilbert of Brienne took charge of William. Gilbert was killed within months, and another guardian, Turchettle, was also killed around the time of Gilbert's death. Yet another guardian, Osborne, was slain in the early 1040s in William's chamber while the duke slept. It was said that Walter, William's maternal uncle, was occasionally forced to hide the young duke in the houses of peasants, although this story may be an embellishment by Orderic Vitalis. The historian Eleanor Searle speculates that William was raised with the three cousins who later became important in his career. William returned to Normandy and were victorious at the Battle of Val-es-Dunes near Caen. Although few details of the actual fighting are recorded, William of Poitiers claimed that the battle was won mainly through William's efforts, but earlier accounts claim that King Henry's men and leadership also played an important part. William assumed power in Normandy, and shortly after the battle promulgated the Truce of God throughout his duchy, in an effort to limit warfare and violence by restricting the days of the year on which fighting was permitted. Although the Battle of Val-es-Dunes marked a turning point in William's control of the duchy, it was not the end of his struggle to gain the upper hand over the nobility. The period from 1047 to 1054 saw almost continuous warfare, with lesser crises continuing until 1060. Consolidation of power. William's next efforts were against Guy of Burgundy, who retreated to his castle at Brienne, which William besieged after a long effort. The duke succeeded in exiling Guy in 1050 to address the growing power of the Count of Anjou, Geoffrey Martel. William joined with King Henry in a campaign against him, the last known cooperation between the two. They succeeded in capturing an Angevin fortress, but accomplished little else. Geoffrey attempted to expand his authority into the county of Maine, especially after the death of Hugh IV of Maine in 1051. Central to the control of Maine were the holdings of the family of Bellamy, who held Bellamy On the border of Maine and Normandy, as well as the fortresses at Alencon and Domfort Bellum's overlord was the King of France, but Domfort was under the overlordship of Geoffrey Martel and Duke William was Alencon's overlord the Bellamy family, whose lands were quite strategically placed between their three different overlords, were able to play each of them against the other and secure virtual independence for themselves. Image from the Bayeux tapestry showing William with his half-brothers William is in the center, Odo is on the left with empty hands, and Robert is on the right with a sword in his hand. On the death of Hugh of Maine, Geoffrey Martel occupied Maine in a move contested by William and King Henry. Eventually they succeeded in driving Geoffrey from the county, and in the process, William was able to secure the Bellamy family strongholds at Alencon and Domfort for himself. He was thus able to assert his overlordship over the Bellamy family and compel them to act consistently in Norman interests. But in 1052 the king and Geoffrey Martel made common cause against William at the same time as some Norman nobles began to contest William's increasing power. Henry's about-face was probably motivated by a desire to retain dominance over Normandy, which was now threatened by William's growing mastery of his duchy. William was engaged in military actions against his own nobles throughout 1053, as well as with the new Archbishop of Rouen, Maugre. In February 1054 the king and the Norman rebels launched a double invasion of the duchy. Henry led the main thrust through the county of Evreux, while the other wing, under the French king's brother Odo, invaded eastern Normandy. William met the invasion by dividing his forces into two groups. The first, which he led, faced Henry II, which included some who became William's firm supporters, such as Robert, Count of EU, Walter Gifford, Roger of Mortimer, and William de Warenne, faced the other invading force. This second force defeated the invaders at the Battle of Mortimer. In addition to ending both invasions, the battle allowed the duke's ecclesiastical supporters to depose Maugre from the Archbishopric of Rouen. Mortimer thus marked another turning point in William's growing control of the duchy. Although his conflict with the French king and the Count of Anjou continued until 1060, Henry and Geoffrey led another invasion of Normandy in 1057 but were defeated by William at the Battle of Varaville. This was the last invasion of Normandy during William's lifetime, and the deaths of the count and the king in 1060 cemented the shift in the balance of power towards William. The signatures of William I and Matilda are the first two large crosses on the Accord of Winchester from 1072. One factor in William's favour was his marriage to Matilda of Flanders, the daughter of Count Baldwin V of Flanders. The union was arranged in 1049, but Pope Leo IX forbade the marriage at the Council of Reims in October 1049. The marriage nevertheless went ahead sometime in the early 1050s, possibly unsanctioned by the Pope according to a late source. Not generally considered to be reliable, papal sanction was not secured until 1059, but as papal-Norman relations in the 1050s were generally good, and Norman clergy were able to visit Rome in 1050 without incident, it was probably secured earlier. Papal sanction of the marriage appears to have required the founding of two monasteries in Caen. There are records of two tutors for the young duke during the late 1030s and early 1040s, but the extent of William's literary education is unclear. He was not known as a patron of authors, and there is little evidence that he sponsored scholarship or other intellectual activities or Duric Vitalis records that William tried to learn to read Old English late in life, but he was unable to devote sufficient time to the effort and quickly gave up. William's main hobby appears to have been hunting. His marriage to Matilda appears to have been quite affectionate, and there are no signs that he was unfaithful to her. Marilius as Archbishop of Rouen. Another important appointment was that of William's half-brother Odo as Bishop of Bayeux in either 1049 or 1050. He also relied on the clergy for advice, including Lanfranc, a non-Norman who rose to become one of William's prominent ecclesiastical advisors in the late 1040s and remained so throughout the 1050s and 1060s. William gave generously to the church. From 1035 to 1066, the Norman aristocracy founded at least 20 new monastic houses, including William's two monasteries in Caen, a remarkable expansion of religious life in the duchy. English and continental concerns. Family relationships of the claimants to the English throne in 1066, and others involved in the struggle. Kings of England are shown in bold in 1051. The childless King Edward of England appears to have chosen William as his successor to the English throne. William was the grandson of Edward's maternal uncle, Richard II, Duke of Normandy. The Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, in the D version, states that William visited England in the later part start of 1051, perhaps to secure confirmation of the succession, or perhaps William was attempting to secure aid for his troubles in Normandy. The trip is unlikely given William's absorption in warfare with Anjou at the time. Whatever Edward's wishes, it was likely that any claim by William would be opposed by Godwin, the Earl of Wessex, a member of the most powerful family in England. Edward had married Edith, Godwin's daughter, in 1043, and Godwin appears to have been one of the main supporters of Edward's claim to the throne by 1050. However, relations between the king and the earl had soured, culminating in a crisis in 1051 that led to the exile of Godwin and his family from England. It was during this exile that Edward offered the throne to William. Godwin returned from exile in 1052 with armed forces, and a settlement was reached between the king and the earl, restoring the earl and his family to their lands and replacing Robert of Jumieges, a Norman whom Edward had named Archbishop of Canterbury, with Stigand, the Bishop of Winchester. No English source mentions a supposed embassy by Archbishop Robert to William conveying the promise of the succession, and the two Norman sources that mention it, William of Jumieges and William of Poitiers, are not precise in their chronology of when this visit took place. Count Herbert II of Maine died in 1062, and William, who had betrothed his eldest son Robert to Herbert's sister Margaret, claimed the county through his son. Local nobles resisted the claim, but William invaded and by 1064 had secured control of the area. William appointed a Norman to the bishopric of Le Mans in 1065. He also allowed his son Robert Curthose to do homage to the new Count of Anjou. Geoffrey the Bearded. William's western border was thus secured, but his border with Brittany remained insecure. In 1064 William invaded Brittany in a campaign that remains obscure in its details. Its effect, though, was to destabilize Brittany, forcing the Duke, Conan II, to focus on internal problems rather than on expansion. Conan's death in 1066 further secured William's borders in Normandy. William also benefited from his campaign in Brittany by securing the support of some Breton nobles who went on to support the invasion of England in 1066. Seen from the Bayeux Tapestry, whose text indicates William supplying weapons to Harold during Harold's trip to the continent in 1064 in England. Earl Godwin died in 1053 and his sons were increasing in power. Harold succeeded to his father's earldom, and another son, Tostig, became Earl of Northumbria. Other sons were granted earldoms later, Gurth as Earl of East Anglia in 1057 and Leofwine as Earl of Kent sometime between 1055 and 1057. Some sources claim that Harold took part in William's Breton campaign of 1064 and that Harold swore to uphold William's claim to the English throne at the end of the campaign, but no English source reports this trip, and it is unclear if it actually occurred. It may have been Norman propaganda designed to discredit Harold, who had emerged as the main contender to succeed King Edward. Meanwhile, another contender for the throne had emerged. Brother of Edwin, Earl of Mercia, as Earl in place of Tostig. Harold, perhaps to secure the support of Edwin and Morcar in his bid for the throne, supported the rebels and persuaded King Edward to replace Tostig with Morcar. Tostig went into exile in Flanders, along with his wife Judith, who was the daughter of Count Baldwin IV of Flanders. Edward was ailing, and he died on 5 January 1066. It is unclear what exactly happened at Edward's deathbed. One story, deriving from the Vita Eduardi, a biography of Edward, claims that Edward was attended by his wife Edith, Harold, Archbishop Stigand, and Robert Fitzwimark, and that the king named Harold as his successor. The Norman sources do not dispute the fact that Harold was named as the next king, but they declare that Harold's oath and Edward's earlier promise of the throne could not be changed on Edward's deathbed. Later English sources stated that Harold had been elected as king by the clergy and magnates of England. Invasion of England. Main article, Norman conquest of England. Harold's preparations. Locations of some of the events in 1066. Harold was crowned on 6 January 1066 in Edward's new Norman-style Westminster Abbey. Although some controversy surrounds who performed the ceremony, English sources claim that Ealdred, the Archbishop of York, performed the ceremony, while Norman sources state that the coronation was performed by Stigand, who was considered a non-canonical archbishop by the papacy. Harold's claim to the throne was not entirely secure, however, as there were other claimants, perhaps including his exiled brother Tostig. King Harald Hardrada of Norway also had a claim to the throne as the uncle and heir of King Magnus I, who had made a pact with Harthacnut in about 1040 that if either Magnus or Harthacnut died without heirs, the other would succeed. The last claimant was William of Normandy, against whose anticipated invasion King Harald Harald Godwinson made most of his preparations. Harald's brother Tostig made probing attacks along the southern coast of England in May 1066, landing at the Isle of Wight using a fleet supplied by Baldwin of Flanders. Tostig appears to have received little local support, and further raids into Lincolnshire and near the River Humber met with no more success, so he retreated to Scotland, where he remained for a time. According to the Norman writer William of Jumieges, William had meanwhile sent an embassy to King Harald Godwinson to remind Harald of his oath to support William's claim, although whether this embassy actually occurred is unclear. Harald assembled an army and a fleet to repel William's anticipated invasion force, deploying troops and ships along the English Channel for most of the summer. William's preparations seen from the Bayeux tapestry showing Normans preparing for the invasion of England. William of Poitiers describes a council called by Duke William, in which the writer gives an account of a great debate that took place between William's nobles and supporters over whether to risk an invasion of England. Although some sort of formal assembly probably was held, it is unlikely that any debate took place, as the Duke had by then established control over his nobles, and most of those assembled would have been anxious to secure their share of the rewards from the conquest of England. William of Poitiers also relates that the Duke obtained the consent of Pope Alexander II for the invasion, along with a papal banner. The chronicler also claimed that the Duke secured the support of Holy Roman Emperor Henry IV and King Swain II of Denmark. Henry was still a minor, however, and Swain was more likely to support Harald, who could then help Swain against the Norwegian king, so these claims should be treated with caution. Although Alexander did give papal approval to the conquest after it succeeded, no other source claims papal support prior to the invasion. Events after the invasion, which included the penance William performed and statements by later popes, do lend circumstantial support to the claim of papal approval to deal with Norman affairs. William put the government of Normandy into the hands of his wife for the duration of the invasion. Throughout the summer, William assembled an army and an invasion fleet in Normandy. Although William of Jumieges's claim that the ducal fleet numbered 3,000 ships is clearly an exaggeration, it was probably large and mostly built from scratch. Although William of Poitiers and William of Jumieges disagree about where the fleet was built. Sailed 2 days later, landing in England at Pevensey Bay on 28 September. William then moved to Hastings, a few miles to the east, where he built a castle as a base of operations. From there, he ravaged the interior and waited for Harald's return from the north, refusing to venture far from the sea. His line of communication with Normandy. Battle of Hastings. Main article, Battle of Hastings. After defeating Harald Hardrada and Tostig, Harald left much of his army in the north, including Morcar and Edwin, and marched the rest south to deal with the threatened Norman invasion. He probably learned of William's landing while he was traveling south. Harald stopped in London, and was there for about a week before marching to Hastings, so it is likely that he spent about a week on his march south, averaging about 27 miles 43 kilometers per day, for the distance of approximately 200 miles 320 kilometers. Although Harald attempted to surprise the Normans, William's scouts reported the English arrival to the Duke. The exact events preceding the battle are obscure, with contradictory accounts in the sources, but all agree that William led his army from his castle and advanced towards the enemy. Harald had taken a defensive position at the top of Senlac Hill, present-day Battle, East Sussex, about 6 miles 97 kilometers from William's castle at Hastings. Seen from the Bayeux tapestry depicting the Battle of Hastings. The battle began at about 9. On the battlefield, Jytha, Harald's mother, offered the victorious Duke the weight of her son's body in gold for its custody, but her offer was refused. William ordered that Harald's body was to be thrown into the sea, but whether that took place is unclear. Waltham Abbey, which had been founded by Harald, later claimed that his body had been secretly buried. Their march on London. William may have hoped the English would surrender following his victory, but they did not. Instead, some of the English clergy and magnates nominated Edgar the Atheling as king, though their support for Edgar was only lukewarm. After waiting a short while, William secured Dover, parts of Kent, and Canterbury, while also sending a force to capture Winchester, where the royal treasury was. These captures secured William's rear areas and also his line of retreat to Normandy. If that was needed, William then marched to Southwark, across the Thames from London, which he reached in late November. Next, he led his forces around the south and west of London, burning along the way. He finally crossed the Thames at Wallingford in early December. Archbishop Stigand submitted to William there, and when the Duke moved on to Berkhamsted soon afterwards, Edgar the Atheling, Morcar, Edwin, and Archbishop Ealdred also submitted. William then sent forces into London to construct a castle. He was crowned at Westminster Abbey on Christmas Day 1066. Consolidation. First actions. William remained in England after his coronation and tried to reconcile the native magnates, the remaining earls. Hereford and revolts at Exeter, where Harold's mother Jytha was a focus of resistance. Fitzosborne and Odo found it difficult to control the native population and undertook a program of castle building to maintain their hold on the kingdom. William returned to England in December 1067 and marched on Exeter, which he besieged. The town held out for 18 days, and after it fell to William, he built a castle to secure his control. Harold's sons were meanwhile raiding the southwest of England from a base in Ireland. Their forces landed near Bristol but were defeated by Eadnoth by Easter. William was at Winchester, where he was soon joined by his wife Matilda, who was crowned in May 1068. English resistance. Main article: harrying of the north. The remains of Bale Hill, the second Mott and Bailey castle built by William in York in 1068. Edwin and Morcar revolted, supported by Gospatric. The chronicler Orderic Vitalis states that Edwin's reason for revolting was that the proposed marriage between himself and one of William's daughters had not taken place, but other reasons probably included the increasing power of William Fitzosborne in Herefordshire, which affected Edwin's power within his own earldom. The king marched through Edwin's lands and built a castle at Warwick. Edwin and Morcar submitted, but William continued on to York, building castles at York and Nottingham before returning south on his southbound journey. The king began constructing castles at Lincoln, Huntingdon, and Cambridge. William placed supporters in charge of these new fortifications. Church affairs. While at Winchester in 1070, William met with three papal legates. Troubles in England and the continent. Danish raids and rebellion in the north. Although Sweyn had promised to leave England, he returned in spring 1070, raiding along the Humber and East Anglia toward the Isle of Ely, where he joined up with Hereward the Wake, a local thegn. Hereward's forces attacked Peterborough Abbey, which they captured and looted. William was able to secure the departure of Sweyn and his fleet in 1070, allowing him to return to the continent to deal with troubles in Maine, where the town of Le Mans had revolted in 1069. Another concern was the death of Count Baldwin V of Flanders in July 1070, which led to a succession crisis as his widow, Richild, was ruling for their two young sons, Arnulf and Baldwin. Her rule, however, was contested by Robert, Baldwin's brother. Richild proposed marriage to William Fitzosborne, who was in Normandy, and Fitzosborne accepted, but after he was killed in February 1071 at the Battle of Castle, Robert became count. He was opposed to King William's power on the continent. Thus the Battle of Castle not only lost the king an important supporter, but also upset the balance of power in northern France. In 1071, William defeated the last rebellion of the North. Earl Edwin was betrayed by his own men and killed, while William built a causeway to subdue the Isle of Ely, where Hereward the Wake and Morcar were hiding. Hereward escaped, but Morcar was captured, deprived of his earldom, and imprisoned. In 1072, William invaded Scotland, defeating Malcolm, who had recently invaded the north of England. William and Malcolm agreed to peace by signing the Treaty of Abernethy, and Malcolm probably gave up his son Duncan as a hostage for the peace. Perhaps another stipulation of the treaty was the expulsion of Edgar the Atheling from Malcolm's court. William then turned his attention to the continent, returning to Normandy in early 1073 to deal with the invasion of Maine by Fulk le Wretched, the Count of Anjou. With a swift campaign, William seized Le Mans from Fulk's forces, completing the campaign by the 30th of March 1073. This made William's power more secure in northern France, but the new Count of Flanders accepted Edgar the Atheling into his court. Robert also married his half-sister Bertha to the King of France, Philip I, who was opposed to Norman power. William returned to England to release his army from service in 1073, but quickly returned to Normandy, where he spent all of 1074. He left England in the hands of his supporters, including Richard Fitzgilbert and William de Warenne, as well as Lanfranc. William's ability to leave England for an entire year was a sign that he felt that his control of the kingdom was secure. While William was in Normandy, Edgar the Atheling returned to Scotland from Flanders. The French king, seeking a focus for those opposed to William's power, then proposed that Edgar be given the castle of Montreuil-sur-Mer on the Channel, which would have given Edgar a strategic advantage against William. Edgar was forced to submit to William shortly thereafter, however, and he returned to William's court. Philip, although thwarted in this attempt, turned his attentions to Brittany, leading to a revolt in 1075. Revolt of the Earls. Main article: Revolt of the Earls. Norwich Castle. The keep dates to after the Revolt of the Earls, but the castle mound is earlier in 1075. During William's absence, Ralph de Gale, the Earl of Norfolk, and Roger de Bretoy, the Earl of Hereford, conspired to overthrow William in the Revolt of the Earls. Ralph was at least part Breton and had spent most of his life prior to 1066 in Brittany, where he still had lands. Roger was a Norman Edmund, son of William Fitzosborne, but had inherited less authority than his father held. Ralph's authority seems also to have been less than his predecessors in the earldom, and this was likely the cause of the revolt. The exact reason for the rebellion is unclear, but it was launched at the wedding of Ralph to a relative of Roger, held at Exning in Suffolk. Another earl, Walthov, although one of William's favourites, was also involved, and there were some Breton lords who were ready to rebel in support of Ralph and Roger. Ralph also requested Danish aid. William remained in Normandy while his men in England subdued the revolt. Roger was unable to leave his stronghold in Herefordshire because of efforts by Wulfstan, the Bishop of Worcester, and Æthelwig, the Abbot of Evesham. Ralph was bottled up in Norwich Castle by the combined efforts of Odo of Bayeux, Geoffrey de Montbray, Richard Fitzgilbert, and William de Warenne. Ralph eventually left Norwich in the control of his wife and left England, finally ending up in Brittany. Norwich was besieged and surrendered, with the garrison allowed to go to Brittany. Meanwhile, the Danish king's brother, Canute, had finally arrived in England with a fleet of 200 ships, but he was too late as Norwich had already surrendered. The Danes then raided along the coast before returning home. William returned to England later in 1075 to deal with the Danish threat, leaving his wife Matilda in charge of Normandy. He celebrated Christmas at Winchester and dealt with the aftermath of the rebellion. Roger and Walthov were kept in prison, where Walthov was executed in May 1076. Before this, William had returned to the continent, where Ralph had continued the rebellion from Brittany. Troubles at home and abroad. Earl Ralph had secured control of the castle at Dahl, and in September 1076 William advanced into Brittany and laid siege to the castle. King Philip of France later relieved the siege and defeated William at Dahl, forcing him to retreat back to Normandy. Although this was William's first defeat in battle, it did little to change things. An Angevin attack on Maine was defeated in late 1076 or 1077, with Count Fulcla Rechin wounded in the unsuccessful attack. More serious was the retirement of Simon de Crepy, the Count of Amiens, to a monastery before he became a monk. Simon handed his county of the Vexin over to King Philip. The Vexin was a buffer state between Normandy and the lands of the French king, and Simon had been a supporter of William. William was able to make peace with Philip in 1077 and secured a truce with Count Fulk in late 1077 or early 1078. In late 1077 or early 1078, trouble began between William and his eldest son, Robert. Although Orduric Vitalis describes it as starting with a quarrel between Robert and his two younger brothers, William and Henry, including a story that the quarrel was started when William and Henry threw water at Robert, it is much more likely that Robert was feeling powerless. Orduric relates that he had previously demanded control of Maine and Normandy and had been rebuffed. The trouble in 1077 or 1078 resulted in Robert leaving Normandy accompanied by a band of young men, many of them the sons of William's supporters. Included among them was Robert of Belmy, William de Bretoy, and Roger, the son of Richard Fitzgilbert. This band of young men went to the castle at Remal, where they proceeded to raid into Normandy. The raiders were supported by many of William's continental enemies. William immediately attacked the rebels and drove them from Remallard, but King Philip gave them the castle at Gerberoy, where they were joined by new supporters. William then laid siege to Gerberoy in January 1079. After 3 weeks, the besieged forces sallied from the castle and managed to take the besiegers by surprise. William was enhorsed by Robert and was only saved from death by an Englishman. William's forces were forced to lift the siege, and the king returned to Rouen by 12 April 1080. William and Robert had reached an accommodation, with William once more affirming that Robert would receive Normandy when he died. Map showing William's lands in 1087. The light pink areas were controlled by William. Word of William's defeat at Gerberoy stirred up difficulties in northern England in August and September 1079. King Malcolm of Scots raided south of the River Tweed, devastating the land between the River Tees and the Tweed in a raid that lasted almost a month. The lack of Norman response appears to have caused the Northumbrians to grow restive, and in the spring of 1080 they rebelled against the rule of Walcher, the Bishop of Durham and Earl of Northumbria. The bishop was killed on 14 May 1080, and William dispatched his half-brother Odo to deal with the rebellion. William departed Normandy in July 1080, and in the autumn William's son Robert was sent on a campaign against the Scots. Robert raided into Lothian and forced Malcolm to agree to terms, building a fortification at Newcastle on Tyne. While returning to England, the king was at Gloucester for Christmas 1080 and at Winchester for Whitsun in 1081, ceremonially wearing his crown on both occasions. A papal embassy arrived in England during this period, asking that William do fealty for England to the papacy, a request that William rejected. William also visited Wales during 1081. Although the English and the Welsh sources differ on the exact purpose of the visit, the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle states that it was a military campaign, but Welsh sources record it as a pilgrimage to St David's in honour of St David Williams. Biographer David Bates argues that the former explanation is more likely, explaining that the balance of power had recently shifted in Wales and that William would have wished to take advantage of the changed circumstances to extend Norman power by the end of 1081. William was back on the continent, dealing with disturbances in Maine, although he led an expedition into Maine. The result was instead a negotiated settlement arranged by a papal legate. Last year's sources for William's actions between 1082 and 1084 are meager, according to the historian David Bates. This probably means that little happened of note, and that because William was on the continent, there was nothing for the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle to record. In 1082, William ordered the arrest of his half-brother Odo. The exact reasons are unclear, as no contemporary author recorded what caused the quarrel between the half-brothers. Orderic Vitalis later recorded that Odo had aspirations to become Pope. Orderic also related that Odo had attempted to persuade some of William's vassals to join Odo on an invasion of southern Italy. This would have been considered tampering with the king's authority over his vassals, which William would not have tolerated. Although Odo remained in confinement for the rest of William's reign, his lands were not confiscated. More difficulties struck in 1083, when William's eldest son Robert rebelled once more with support from the French king. A further blow was the death of Matilda, William's wife. On 2 November 1083, William was always described as close to his wife, and her death would have added to his problems. Maine continued to be difficult, with a rebellion by Hubert de Beaumont au Maine. Probably in 1084, Hubert was besieged in his castle at St. Suzanne by William's forces for at least 2 years, but he eventually made his peace with the king and was restored to favor. William's movements during 1084 and 1085 are unclear. Allowed garrisons to be protected while they occupied the countryside. The early castles were simple earth and timber constructions, later replaced with stone structures at first. Most of the newly settled Normans kept household knights and did not settle their retainers with fiefs of their own, but gradually these household knights came to be granted lands of their own, a process known as subinfeudation. William also required his newly created magnates to contribute fixed quotas of knights towards not only military campaigns but also castle garrisons. This method of organizing the military forces was a departure from the pre-conquest English practice of basing military service on territorial units such as the Hyde. By William's death, after weathering a series of rebellions, most of the native Anglo-Saxon aristocracy had been replaced by Norman and other continental magnates. Not all of the Normans who accompanied William in the initial conquest acquired large amounts of land in England. Some appear to have been reluctant to take up lands in a kingdom that did not always appear pacified. Although some of the newly rich Normans in England came from William's close family or from the upper Norman nobility, others were from relatively humble backgrounds. William granted some lands to his continental followers from the holdings of one or more specific Englishmen. At other times, he granted a compact grouping of lands previously held by many different Englishmen to one Norman follower, often to allow for the consolidation of lands around a strategically placed castle. The medieval chronicler William of Malmesbury says that the king also seized and depopulated many miles of land, 36 parishes, turning it into the royal New Forest region to support his enthusiastic enjoyment of hunting. Modern historians have come to the conclusion that the New Forest depopulation was greatly exaggerated. Most of the lands of the New Forest are poor agricultural lands, and archaeological and geographic studies have shown that the New Forest was likely sparsely settled when it was turned into a royal forest. William was known for his love of hunting, and he introduced the forest law into areas of the country, regulating who could hunt and what could be hunted. Administration. Main article, Norman Conquest of England. Section. Normandy, England, and Maine continued to exist separate from the other lands, with each one retaining its own forms. For example, England continued the use of writs, which were not known on the continent. Also, the charters and documents produced for the government in Normandy differed in formulas from those produced in England. William took over an English government that was more complex than the Norman system. England was divided into shires or counties, which were further divided into either hundreds or wapentakes. Each shire was administered by a royal official called a sheriff, who roughly had the same status as a Norman viscount. A sheriff was responsible for royal justice and collecting royal revenue to oversee his expanded domain. William was forced to travel even more than he had as Duke. He crossed back and forth between the continent and England at least 19 times between 1067 and his death. William spent most of his time in England between the Battle of Hastings and 1072, and after that he spent the majority of his time in Normandy. Government was still centered on William's household. When he was in one part of his realms, decisions decisions would be made for other parts of his domains and transmitted through a communication system that made use of letters and other documents. William also appointed deputies who could make decisions while he was absent, especially if the absence was expected to be lengthy. Usually this was a member of William's close family.